Willem Prinsloo's Peach Brandy by Herman Charles Bosman. No, Oom Schalk Lorenz said, you don't get flowers in the Groot Mariko. It is not a bad district for mealies, and I once grew quite good onions in a small garden I made next to the dam. But what you can really call flowers are rare things here. Perhaps it's the heat, or the drought. Yet, whenever I talk about flowers, I think of Willem Prinsloo's farm on a Beaterskop, where the dance was. And I think of Fritz Pretorius, sitting pale and sick by the roadside. And I think of the white rose that I wore in my hat, jauntily. But most of all, I think of Grieta. If you walk over my farm to the Hoogte and look towards the northwest, you can see Abjaterskop behind the ridge of the Dwarsberge. People will tell you that there are ghosts on Abjaterskop, and that it was once the home of witches. I can believe that. I was at Abjaterskop only once. That was many years ago. And I never went there again. Still, it wasn't the ghost that kept me away. Nor was it the witches. Grieta Prinsloo was due to come back from the finishing school at Zeerust, where she'd gone to learn English manners and dictation and other high-class subjects. Therefore, Willem Prinsloo, her father, arranged a big dance on his farm at the Pjaterskop to celebrate Grieta's return. I was invited to the party. So was Fritz Pretorius. So was every white person in the district, from Derdepoort to Remotse. And what was more, practically everybody went. Of course, we were all somewhat nervous about meeting Grieta. With all the superior things she'd learnt at the finishing school, we wouldn't be able to talk to her in a chatty sort of way, just as though she were an ordinary boer girl. But what fetched us all to Abjaterskop in the end was our knowledge that Willem Prinsloo made the best peach brandy in the district. Fritz Pretorius spoke to me about the difficulty brought about by Grieta's learning. Yes, young, he said. I'm feeling pretty shaky about talking to her, I can tell you. Well, I've been rubbing up on my education a bit, though. Yesterday I took out my old slate that I last used when I left school 17 years ago and did a few sums. I did some addition and subtraction. I tried a little multiplication too, but I've forgotten how it's done. I told Fritz that I would have liked to have helped him, but I'd never learnt as far as multiplication. The day of the dance arrived. The postcard bearing Grieta to her father's house passed through Droogedal in the morning. In the afternoon, I got dressed. I wore a black jacket, fawn trousers, and a pink shirt. I also put on the brown boots that I'd bought about a year before and that I'd never had occasion to wear. For I would have looked silly walking about the farm in a pair of shop boots when everybody else wore homemade veldskoens. I believed, as I got on my horse and set off down the government road with my hat rakishly to one side, that I would be easily the best-dressed young man at that dance. It was getting on towards sunset when I arrived at the foot of Abjaterskop, which I had to skirt in order to reach Willem Prinsloo's farm, nestling in a hollow behind the hills. I felt, as I rode, that it was stupid for a man to live in a part that was reputed to be haunted. The trees grew taller and denser, as they always do on rising ground. And they also got a lot darker. All over the place were queer, heavy shadows, and I did not like the look of them. I remembered stories I'd heard of the witches of Abjaterskop, and what they did to travellers who lost their way in the dark. It seemed an easy thing to lose your way amongst those tall trees. Accordingly, I spurred my horse onto a gallop to get out of this gloomy region as quickly as possible. I mean, after all, a horse is sensitive about things like ghosts and witches, and it was my duty to see my horse was not frightened unnecessarily. especially as a cold wind suddenly sprung up through the poort, and once or twice it sounded as though an evil voice were calling my name. I started riding fast then. But a few moments later, I looked around and realized the position. It was Fritz Pretorius galloping along behind me.
"What's your hurry?"
Fritz asked, when I had slowed down to allow his overtaking me. "Oh, I wish to get through those trees before it was too dark," I answered. I didn't want my horse to get frightened.
"Ah, I suppose that's why you were riding with your arms around his neck,"
Fritz observed.
"To soothe him."
I did not reply. But what I did notice was that Fritz was also very stylishly dressed. True, I beat him as far as shirt and boots went, but he was dressed in a new grey suit, with his socks pulled up over the bottoms of his trousers. He also had a handkerchief, which he ostentatiously took out of his pocket several times. Of course, I couldn't be jealous of a person like Fritz Pretorius. I was only annoyed at the thought that he was making himself ridiculous by going to a party with an outlandish thing like a handkerchief. We arrived at Willem Prinsloo's house. There were so many ox wagons drawn up on the veld that the place looked like a lager. Prinsloo met us at the door. "Go through, carols," he said. "The dancing is in the voorhuis. The peach brandy is in the kitchen." Although the voorhuis was big, it was so crowded as to make it almost impossible to dance. But it was not as crowded as the kitchen, nor was the music in the voorhuis, which was provided by a number of men with guitars and concertinas, as loud as the music in the kitchen, where there was no band, but each man sang for himself. We knew from these signs that the party was a success. When I'd been in the kitchen for about half an hour, I decided to go into the voorhuis. It seemed a long way now from the kitchen to the voorhuis, and I had to lean against the wall several times to think. I passed a number of other men who were also leaning against the wall like that, thinking. One man even found that he could think best by sitting on the floor with his head in his arms. You could see that Willem Prinsloo made good peach brandy. Then I saw Fritz Pretorius, and the sight of him brought me to my senses right away. Nearly flapping his white handkerchief in time with the music, he was talking to a girl who smiled up at him with bright eyes and red lips and small white teeth. I knew at once that it was Greta. She was tall and slender and very pretty, and her dark hair was braided with a wreath of white roses that you could see had been picked that morning in Zierist. And she did not look the sort of girl either in whose presence you had to appear clever and educated. In fact, I felt I wouldn't really need the 12 times table which I'd torn off the back of a school writing book and had thrust into my jacket pocket before leaving home. You can imagine that it was not too easy for me to get a word in with Grieta while Fritz was hanging around, but I managed it eventually. And while I was talking to her, I had the satisfaction of seeing out of the corner of my eye the direction Fritz took. He went into the kitchen, flapping his handkerchief behind him, into the kitchen where the laughter was and the singing, and Willem Prinsloo's peach brandy. I told Grieta that I was Schalk Lawrence.
"Oh yes, I've heard of you," she answered, "from Fritz Pretorius."
I knew what that meant, so I told her that Fritz was known all over the Mariko for his lies. I told her other things about Fritz. 10 minutes later, when I was still talking about him, Grieta smiled and said that I could tell her the rest some other night. "But I must tell you one more thing now," I insisted. "When he knew that he'd be meeting you here at the dance, Fritz started doing homework." I told her about the slate and the sums, and Grieta laughed softly. It struck me again how pretty she was, and her eyes were radiant in the candlelight, and the roses looked very white against her dark hair. And all this time the dancers whirled around us, and the band in the forays played lively dance tunes, and from the kitchen there issued weird sounds of jubilation. The rest happened very quickly. I can't even remember how it all came about, but what I do know is that when we were outside under the tall trees with the stars over us, I could easily believe that Rita was not a girl at all, but one of the witches of Abiaterskop who wove strange spells. Yet to listen to my talking, nobody would have guessed the wild, thrilling things that were in my heart. I told Rita about last year's drought, and about the difficulty of keeping the white ants from eating through the door and window frames, and about the way my new brown boots tended to take the skin off my toe if I walked quickly. Then I moved close up to her. "Grita," I said, taking her hand, "Grita, there is something I want to tell you." She pulled her hand away. She did it gently, though. Sorrowfully, almost.
"I know what you want to say," she answered.
I was surprised at that. "How do you know, Grita?" I asked.
"Oh, I know lots of things," she replied, laughing again. "I haven't been to finishing school for nothing."
"I don't mean that," I answered at once. I wasn't going to talk about spelling or arithmetic. I was going to tell you...
"Say it, Schalk," Grita interrupted me. I don't know whether I'm worthy of hearing it. I don't even...
"But you're so lovely," I exclaimed. "I've got to tell you how lovely you are." But at that very moment I stepped forward, she retreated swiftly, eluding me. I could not understand how she timed it so well. For try as I might, I couldn't catch her. She sped lightly and gracefully amongst the trees, and I followed as best I could. Yet it was not only my want of learning that handicapped me. There was also my new brown boots, and Willem Prinsloo's peach brandy, and the shaft of a mule cart, the lower end of the shaft, which rests in the grass. I did not fall very hard, though. The grass was long and thick there. But even as I fell, a great happiness came into my heart, and I did not care about anything else in the world. Rita had stopped running. She turned around. For an instant, her body, slender and misty in the shadows, swayed towards me. Then a hand flew to her hair. Her finger pulled at the wreath. And the next thing I knew was that there lay, within reach of my hand, a small white rose. I shall always remember the thrill with which I picked up that rose, and how I trembled when I stuck it in my hat. I shall always remember the stir I caused when I walked into the kitchen. Everybody stopped drinking to look at the white rose in my hat. The young men made jokes about it. The older men winked slyly and patted me on the back. And although Fritz Pretorius was not in the kitchen to witness my triumph, I knew he would get to hear about it somehow. That would make him realize that it was impudence for a fellow like him to set up a Schalk Lawrence's rival. During the rest of the night, I was a hero. The men in the kitchen made me sit on the table. They plied me with brandy and drank to my health. And afterwards, when a dozen of them carried me outside onto an ox wagon for fresh air, they fell with me only once. At daybreak, I was still on that wagon. I woke up feeling very sick, until I remembered about Rita's rose. There was that white rose still stuck in my hat for the whole world to know that Gritte Prinsloo had chosen me before all other men. But what I didn't want people to know was that I'd remained asleep on that ox wagon hours after the other guests had gone. So I rode away very quietly, glad that nobody was astir to see me go. My head was dizzy as I rode, but in my heart it felt like green wings beating. And although it was day now, there was the same soft wind in the grass that had been there when Gritte flung the rose at me, standing under the stars. I rode slowly through the trees on the slope of Abiaterskop, and had reached the place where the path turned south again, when I saw something that made me wonder if, at all these fashionable finishing schools, they did not perhaps teach the girls too much. First, I saw Fritz Pretorius's horse by the roadside. Then I saw Fritz. He was sitting up against a thorn tree with his chin resting on his knees. He looked very pale and sick. But what made me wonder much about those finishing schools was that in Fritz's hat, which had fallen on the ground some distance away from him, there was a small white rose.